know, not only what God says to us, but the faith where they say, you know, and I believe, that faith that it takes just gets me. So yes, my name is Madison Hungerford. This is my first Women's Day speaking, so thank you guys for being gracious with me and listening to a little bit about my story and what God has really placed on my heart this year. I love this theme that we're talking about, the gifts, I mean, not the gifts of imperfection, the perfectly imperfect. I love this theme that we're talking about, and there are many gifts to imperfection. So, like Julie said, I'm 24, was just married almost 3 years now, so I still feel very much like a newlywed, new to ministry, I'm new to being a grief recovery specialist, I'm new to a lot of things in my life right now, and I feel very young in a lot of ways. But in that, I'm very familiar with battling insecurity and battling imperfection. I am very familiar with shame. So I just want to share a little bit about my story with you guys. And I've been really wrestling with what to say because nothing exposes your imperfections like being asked to speak about imperfection. So this won't be perfect, but I just prayed a lot about this, that it's something that God wants to be said. So I'm going to start in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7. And it says, "Therefore, in order to keep me from becoming conceited, I was given a thorn in my flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me. Three times I pleaded with the Lord to take it away from me, but he said, 'My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses, so that Christ's power may rest on me. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in my weaknesses, in insults, in hardships, in persecutions, in difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong.'" I love this chapter, this verse so much. It's incredibly empowering. You know, when I'm weak, then I'm strong. But it's also scary because it's talking about delighting in our weaknesses, the things that we spend so much time covering up and pretending they're not there. It really helps me to be in touch with God's grace so much, my imperfections. And this, it's been a journey learning to delight in my weaknesses. So I just want to share some of those with you guys today. So I've been familiar with shame since childhood. I had a very, what I call a loss of innocence, which at about 8 years old, after a very premature sexual awakening, really understood shame for the first time. Some of you may have noticed I'm very tall, I'm 5'10", and I felt very out of place. I've been 5'10" since I was a freshman in high school, so I felt very out of place for a long time. I had a very low sense of self-worth since I was very young, and always really found my identity in being someone's girlfriend, and even stayed in a relationship for over 3 years as a teenager because I was really afraid that I would never find something better, that I would never find someone, you know, who truly loved me or loved God. It's a very low sense of self-worth. I grew up with four beautiful friends who were like sisters to me, but with that came a lot of insecurity of feeling like the unfavored one. In a group, always feeling comparing myself to the other women. They're beautiful, talented women. I love them, but always feeling less than, less pretty than, less thin than, less spiritual, funny, all sorts of things. Always felt like I was comparing myself to them. And to top it all off, I was born at the beginning of the information age. So social media has been a part of my life since middle school, longer for probably some of the girls here. And I'm a part of an entire generation whose identity is based on how many Facebook friends we have and Instagram followers and YouTube subscribers. Our identity is based on the image that we carefully portray to the world. And this affects you. This has affected me. People suddenly knew me based on that image that I could carefully create. And this really carried into my adulthood. I believed that my height and my quiet, I'm a very introverted person naturally, my height and my quiet quietness made me weird, and it made me unable to fit in, unable to make friends, experience true belonging. So I really tried to hide them. I tried to hide these imperfections, these weaknesses of mine. I did this by slouching a lot. I still have to work on my posture. I starved myself throughout high school on and off. And I overexercised, played volleyball, constantly exercising as much as I could to be as thin as these other girls. Like I said, I stayed even in a bad relationship because I felt chosen. I felt wanted by someone. Even if it wasn't the person that I was truly in love with, it was someone who wanted me and chose me, so I stayed. I worked very hard to prove my worth. I wanted so badly to feel accepted and fully known by people and loved. I tried so hard. And after a lot of really painful wounds and experiences and even my own mistakes, even in church growing up, there was, I really struggled and lost my trust for a lot of people and forgot my trust in God for a while. There was a lot of wounds in my heart, and it was a really hard time. This was as an adult, and there was a lot of wounds there. I really struggled to let people into my life again and trust, especially women, with my true self and my true feelings and my true thoughts, because I felt like I had invested in relationships that were somehow now gone. And so should I do this again if they're going to just disappear on me? But God really led me to a wonderful group of Christians where there would take place a lot of healing, a lot of growth, and a lot of love. So now everything's perfect, right? Everything's good to go. Find the right church and you're good. No, wrong. I'm still growing every single day, still healing every single day. And so fast forwarding into this new church that I'm a part of, this is in Eugene. We have these Wednesday night women's Bible studies, and sometimes we get together in groups of four or five women afterwards and kind of ask deep questions and go more in depth in the scriptures. So I said, you know, I'm struggling because I feel like I'm trying so hard to be vulnerable and be myself and, you know, have these deep relationships, but I feel like it's not reciprocated. Like, why am I not close to people? I try so hard. And a loving sister with much more life experience than me told it to me pretty straight. She said, it's because you're not vulnerable. You're not vulnerable, and this is a weakness of yours. And, you know, you make me feel judged and criticized because of the way that you are. And I was like, oh, okay, thank you. It was a really hard pill to swallow. So once again, shame. I felt like I tried so hard to be what people wanted me to be and to let people in again, but somehow I was still not enough. And this was really, really painful. Not vulnerable enough, not warm enough, kind enough, spiritual enough, not enough. So this was a really hard time for me. So I wanted to honor God so badly, and I felt like I was at the end of my rope. Like I had tried everything and I worked really hard, but somehow I still fell short. Have you guys ever gotten to that point where you're just like, I've tried everything, and I'm ready to throw my hands in the air and be like, I'm done. I've tried being vulnerable. It's not for me. Like, I'm not good at it. I was at that point where, you know, I really was asking myself, will I ever overcome this? Will I ever be personable and warm and vulnerable? Will this ever be behind me? Will this ever be my strength? That seems impossible. And after about 2 whole days of crying and eating my feelings, which were mostly fried and chocolate, a lot of sleepless nights, and pretty much blaming everyone else I could think of for the way that I was, I did what any good millennial would do. I went to the place with all the answers. Google. I decided to Google it. What does it mean to be vulnerable? People tell me I need to be vulnerable. What does this mean, Google? So after countless hours of TED Talks which were mostly by Brené Brown. Check it out if you haven't heard of her. A lot of Bible studies, a lot of prayer, a lot of podcasts and advice and soul searching and all that we do when we're perplexed, like what is it going to take for me to get through this? I want to share with you guys what I discovered. Here's what I discovered. God created us to be perfectly imperfect and to enjoy extraordinary, intimate relationships with one another and with Him. He created us for relationships that are intimate with both Him and each other. But intimate relationships require vulnerability. And vulnerability is really scary. It takes a lot of courage to be vulnerable, to say the things that we don't ever want to say out loud. Over in John, 1 John chapter 1, verse 5, it says, God is light. In Him there is no darkness at all. If we claim to have fellowship with Him and yet walk in the darkness, we lie and do not live out the truth. But if we walk in the light as He is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus, His Son, purifies us from all sin. So this word fellowship here, it means, it's in the root word, it's koinonia, and it means community and partnership and intimacy. God wants us to have these intimate relationships with each other and with Him. And Satan really does everything he can to get in the way of this, doesn't he? He does everything to get between us and our relationships with each other, especially with women. This world has taught us to be so catty and just claw at each other to get to the top. Satan really tries to convince us to walk in the dark, to cover up our imperfections, that we don't need relationships. He really tells us that I don't need people, I just need myself, or I just need me and God and I'm good, I don't need other people. That is a lie. And he tells us that we have to be perfect in order to be loved, that we have to continue to grow and just be all these perfect things and hide the imperfections so that people will love us. But something I found is that perfectionism, and I think a lot of us women will call ourselves perfectionists, perfectionism, it's a lie from Satan to keep us from being close to one another. Perfectionism is a lie from Satan. But what leads us to want to be perfectionists? For me, I think it's shame. I think it's being ashamed of things of our past, things that we don't want to be said out loud. I don't want people to know I'm tall, so I'm going to slouch and kind of stand on my hip a little bit and, you know, do anything I can to cover up my imperfections. But God, He doesn't love us based on what we do or based on how perfect we are. He loves us because of who He is, which is our Father, our perfect Father. So I want to share a little bit about the first woman who ever experienced shame, and that's Eve. So I'm not going to read the whole story, but read the first couple chapters of Genesis, and especially Genesis chapter 3 is where I'm going to be reading from. It's a beautiful story about the way that God created the world. He created Adam, and then He created his wife, Eve. And it says in chapter 2, verse 25, that Adam and his wife felt no shame. They were completely naked, felt no shame. There's just this absolute vulnerability, purity, and safety with each other and with God. That's such a beautiful picture. Like, there's no fear of people seeing who we truly are. I can't even imagine that sometimes. It's really hard to imagine what that would be like. And in Genesis chapter 3, verse 1, we see God asked them one thing in this beautiful garden. He said, just don't eat from this one tree. It's the knowledge of good and evil. So in chapter 3, verse 1, we see Satan come as in the form of a serpent. It says, now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden? The woman said to the serpent, we may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but did God say you must not eat from it, from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it or you will die? You will not certainly die, the serpent said to the woman, for God knows that when you eat from it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye and also desirable for gaining wisdom, She took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate it. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they realized they were naked, so they sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves. I think that the temptation here that's from Satan is the fruit to me really represents perfectionism. The temptation to be like God, ultimate perfection. I don't need anybody or anything. I don't need God. I am perfect all the way that I am. And that's just not how God created us. He created us to be distinctly different from one another and distinctly dependent on him and each other. And you know what? Eve believed the lie. And I think a lot of us believe this lie on a daily basis, that we have to be perfect in order to be loved. And that's exhausting because nobody can be really perfect. So then we give up and we say, fine, I can't be perfect. Then I don't need people, so I don't need to be loved. And we're not even going to talk about Adam. He's got his own story. But we see sin enter the world here, and the consequence of this sin is shame. It says that suddenly they felt shame. They realized they were naked. So when I say shame, I want to define what I mean by that. Shame is the intensely painful belief that we are imperfect and therefore unworthy of love and belonging, that something we've experienced, done, or failed to do makes us unworthy of connection. Shame is painful, right? Like, nobody enjoys feeling shame or embarrassment. And I want to define that shame and guilt are different. Shame or guilt is I did something bad. Guilt is like a hunger that tells us, hey, something's wrong here. You know, I did something wrong. And guilt can be from God, and it's okay. But shame is I am bad. And God created this world without any shame. I think that's incredible. There was no shame in the beginning between humans and God. And that's how he wants it. He doesn't want us to experience shame. But how do we react when we feel shame usually? I think we hide and we self-protect. In verse 8, it says, the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and they hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord called to the man, where are you? He answered, I heard you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid. And he said, who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree that I commanded you not to eat from? The man said, the woman you put here with me, she gave me some fruit from the tree, and I ate it. Then the Lord God said to the woman, what is this you have done? And the woman said, the serpent deceived me, and I ate. See, they realized their mistake. They felt the guilt, but rather than walking in the light with each other, to have the fellowship with God and each other, they chose to cover. I think we all know this temptation to cover up our imperfections. And they used fig leaves, which to cover up their vulnerable parts when they realized that they were exposed. And fig leaves are prickly and dry, and the word that it's used for is armor, their coverings. They covered up the vulnerable parts of themselves from God. But they're so flimsy, right? Fig leaves, they're like, you know, like paper. It doesn't make sense. But I think that our coverings are very flimsy too, the way that we try to cover up our shame. I think we can binge on some good Netflix, Gilmore Girls and Friends, The Office. Am I the only one? Okay, that's okay. social media, hours of scrolling, Facebook or Instagram, looking at everybody else, shopping, Amazon, come on, so click away from something that you want. I think self-medicating is a big one, alcohol, drugs, even food. For me, I really stuff my feelings down, and I stuff my face. I overeat, and I numb out. I get a nice bowl of something good, something crunchy, and I pop my headphones in, and I open my laptop, and it's like zone out. Like, I don't feel anything. And I think that's how I can really hide and self-protect, is I just don't feel anything. But I found that walking in the light means vocalizing the shame that we feel with other women and with God. It means talking about those feelings and cultivating openness in our relationships. And even this week I felt this about this lesson, trying to open up and share, hey, this is what I think I want to share, and different people giving me input and battling I'm the worst. They shouldn't have picked me. Like, I shouldn't be doing this. I can't write a lesson. And, you know, over and over, this happened like 4 times this week. And so, you know, I'm familiar with the shame. But I've been really trying to go after cultivating this kind of openness in my relationships, because it's the only way to fight back against shame, is to say it out loud. And we see, how does God respond to them when he sees their mistakes? I see him respond with so much love and gentleness. He doesn't shame them for their mistakes. In fact, he actually just asks some questions. I always say that Jesus is the master question asker. He just says the things to pull the truth out of our hearts and let us choose if we want to walk in the light or not. He doesn't force us to walk in the light. He lets us choose. You know, I see him come to them patiently. He waits until the cool of the day. He comes to them personally, addressing them individually and directly. He comes to them with care before the darkness of night, where they'd have to battle all night long by themselves. But he also comes to them with truth, and he shows them their lost position. And he says, "Where are you?" But this is so counterintuitive to God, right? Because God knows where we are always. He knows everything. But we see later in the Bible that Jesus says he came to seek and save the lost. And I love that God already knows where we are, but he sent his son to come and find us in our lostness. And he explains to them the consequences of their sin, because there is consequences. But in verse 21, I see him say, "The Lord God made garments of skin for Adam and his wife, and he clothed them." And I never noticed that until this week as I was reading this out. That God removed their armor, their prickly, flimsy armor. He takes that away. And he lovingly gave them coverings for themselves. He doesn't force them to walk in the light. But even on our way out the door, doesn't God do that? Like, he just consistently encourages us and is constantly trying to allure us back to him with anything that he can. Because God understands shame, and he wants to provide the healing from it. But healing comes from walking in the light, and Adam and Eve, they don't do that. They cover up. They cover themselves, their vulnerability, and so God lets them. But we can walk in the light with each other and with God. Because it's a part of our purpose to love God and to love each other. And I really, really believe that imperfections are a gift from God, that they allow us to have compassion on one another and to connect with each other, especially when we share them openly and without shame. I think that as we have to remember as well, when others share with us, to be compassionate and not to criticize, because it's easy to see our flaws, and it's easy to see flaws in others, but allow that to produce compassion and connection in our relationships. And like Julie said, we're going to be planting a church this summer in Bend, which is really exciting, except it also really exposes my weaknesses. just like being up here does. I've been wearing these white pants. I've never worn white pants before, and I've been really nervous about getting something on them. And I was like, you know what? We're talking about imperfections. If I spill some vegan pudding on my pants, it's okay. I almost did. So it exposes my imperfections a lot. But God has really taught me something through that. He's taught me that he doesn't want me to be perfect. He wants me to be mature and complete by walking in the light with my sisters and with him. To not let fear and shame control my mind, but rather to lean into vulnerability by sharing my imperfections openly with my sisters and not being afraid. He's taught me to delight in my weaknesses, because ultimately they give him the glory and not me. And that's the whole point. It's to bring glory to him, not ourselves. To not believe the lie of perfection, but to remember that I am created perfectly imperfect, to bring glory and honor to him. So, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses, so that Christ's power may rest on me. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in my weaknesses, in insults, in hardships, in persecutions, and difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong. Thank you.